The definitions and terminology related to polygons form the basis for a number of extended mathematical concepts. This week, we'll look at the properties of polygons that allow them to form tessellations and polyhedra. Although it seems like these kinds of geometrical concepts should be of purely mathematical interest, it turns out nature likes to work mathematically too, and that tessellations have even more applications than to design interesting tilings in your bathroom. So firstly, what is a tessellation? We say that a tessellation is a covering of the plane, so we're talking about two-dimensional designs here, without overlaps or gaps. Technically, we could consider a tessellation to be any arrangement of shapes that fit perfectly together and could cover a plane indefinitely in every direction, but we're more interested in those ones that exhibit some kind of pattern or regularity. We might not expect bees to care as much about tessellations as we do. After all, it doesn't seem like a bee would even know what a polygon is, but the honeycomb arrangement of hexagons they use ends up being very economical, allowing efficient storage of honey for the amount of material required. Since the hexagons used are also regular, with the same angles and same side lengths, we refer to this kind of tessellation as a regular tessellation, i.e. a tessellation that uses a single regular polygon. However, we also usually require the shapes to come together with the same arrangement at a vertex. So this arrangement of squares would be a regular tessellation, but this brick-type arrangement wouldn't. And although rectangles tessellate, since they aren't regular, we wouldn't refer to this as a regular tessellation either. Now, one way to think of tessellations is in terms of these tiles, which due to their angle properties are able to fit together perfectly because the internal angles sum to 360 degrees. However, we can also think about tessellations being formed by starting with a single shape that is then copied and moved about the plane in a prescriptive way to make these infinite patterns. To describe such processes, we need to talk about isometries. So isometries are spatial operations that preserve size and shape. We can have translation or sliding, so we start with a square and then translate it so that opposite sides sit against each other. In doing so, every point of the square has moved a fixed direction and distance. Then we can have rotation or turning. With rotation, we fix a shape at a particular point, and then the whole shape turns a given angle about that point, either clockwise or anti-clockwise. With a square, since its angles are 90 degrees, we can rotate the square at any of the vertices in order to cover the plane. We can also rotate them around the midpoints. In this case, we'll be fixing the midpoint of one of the sides and rotating the square 180 degrees so that the side sits against itself. The other isometry of the plane we could use is reflection or flipping. With reflection, we have this axis of reflection, and then every point of the shape is flipped to the other side of that axis. Operations like enlarging or distorting are not isometries because they don't preserve the shape and size. As well as tessellations of single shapes, we can use combinations of shapes. A particular type that we'll briefly look at, referred to as semi-regular or homogeneous tessellations, still use regular shapes and require the same arrangement at each vertex. However, now we are allowed to use more than one. You can see with this arrangement of octagons and squares that no matter which vertex you pick, you'll always be able to see one square and two octagons as you move around clockwise. There are many other special types of tessellations, and we won't go into them too much. However, one worth mentioning is one discovered by Sir Roger Penrose. This one is interesting because, although the shapes used are able to fit together infinitely, the actual pattern itself will never repeat. For instance, if you translate it across. This inspired the Kleenex company to emboss it on their toilet tissues, since the lack of repetition should mean the layers of a toilet roll wouldn't stick together. This might have been very nice thinking if the company had asked Roger for permission and if he hadn't patented the design years earlier. The company that held the rights to the design said, So often we read of very large companies riding roughshod over small businesses or individuals, but when it comes to the population of Great Britain being invited by a multinational company to wipe their bottoms on what appears to be the work of a knight of the realm without his permission, then a last stand must be made. And the product was withdrawn. The other concept of interest to us this week is that of polyhedra. A polyhedron is essentially the extension of the polygon definition to three-dimensional space. So whereas a polygon is a 2D closed shape with straight sides, a polyhedron is a three-dimensional closed shape whose faces are polygons. We usually use the term faces or surfaces instead of sides in order to distinguish these from the edges. Now with tessellations, we need shapes with internal angles summing exactly 360 degrees coming together at a vertex. With polyhedra, we need strictly less, otherwise we'll just end up with a flat surface or shapes overlapping. So one of the ways we can think about the possibilities is by considering arrangements of polygons that do leave a gap, for instance, using three hexagons we obtained a regular tessellation, however if we have three pentagons, there'll be a little left over. And when we close this up and continue the construction of the shape in the same way the whole way around, we'll end up with a dodecahedron. Now as we had regular and semi-regular tessellations, we can also have regular and semi-regular solids. A regular solid requires a single regular polygon to be used, with the same arrangement at every vertex. These are also given a special name, the Platonic solids. The semi-regular solids are called the Archimedean solids, and one of the most recognizable of these is the hexagon and pentagons formation that gives us a polyhedron that the soccer ball is based on. We'll briefly investigate these shapes this week, along with some special features and relationships. It's another vocabulary-intensive week, so be sure to practice using these terms as much as you can, referring to your notes where needed in order to remember them and become more fluent in using them.